want to make a podcast? Spotify's got a platform that's going to let you make one super easily. And then you can distribute it everywhere and even earn money doing this. All in one place. And it's free. It's called Spotify for Podcasters. Here's how it works. Spotify for Podcasters lets you record and even edit your podcast right from your phone or your computer. Then you can distribute your podcast to Spotify and everywhere else podcasts are heard.
You know, ever since we discovered Spotify for Podcasters, it's been really great. Really get the people involved and ask questions and get ideas for new podcasts. So it's really helped us. And, you know, I highly recommend you give it a try. So download the Spotify for Podcasters app or go to www.spotify.com/podcasters to get started.
Fool me, we can't get fooled again.
In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
You don't know what you're talking about, sir.
Because people have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook. I've earned everything I've got.
If you don't like what we tell you to believe in, we'll kill you.
All right, kids. Listen. Don't Start listen again. To this podcast.
Don't listen to this.
If you're not of age.
What's of age?
18. So 16? 18. We're a bunch of dudes. And we're going to say some really bad words.
Hey, guys. Welcome back to the Conspiracy Podcast. Yo.
Here we are once
yo-ho.
Again.
Yo-ho. Yo-ho. A pirate's life for podcast. Me.
And a bottle of neutral.
Yeah, we're drinking gluten-free because we can't get fat.
Well, it's too. Well, it
doesn't count.
Might be a little bit. Might be a little too late.
This is like water.
Yeah, YouTube told me if I get out gluten, then I'm not fat.
Mm-hmm.
That's true, right?
I'm subscribing to that.
Yeah, probably has no sugar too.
Gluten you makes you fat.
It's probably like I think that's the tagline of these are like don't be fat.
Yeah,
it's like neutral.
Yeah, unfortunately, gluten tastes great. I don't know what
dude,
it tastes
it's
like.
Delicious.
Can you go buy a bottle of gluten?
I mean, you probably can't.
It's not. Bottled.
I'm just kidding. Okay. Can you go to Whole Foods? Give me an organic gluten.
Like a fucking gluten. Like a mustard bottle, like on your sandwich. It's just like gluten.
I just want your best gluten. Grab the shit in the back.
You know? Like the top shelf gluten.
Yeah, I want the gluten. Crazy gluten.
Imagine seeing that on a menu at like Salt Bae's restaurant. Like gold foil gluten.
Gold gluten.
That's the most ridiculous fucking shit in a fucking gold steak that they come
I know,
off.
Like, why would you even want that? Like, I don't want that. I don't want gold. I don't want metal on my steak.
Isn't it like $1,000 that they sell it for? It's so ridiculous.
It's so dumb. Mm. Just to have a Turkish man sprinkle salt down his arm on my steak? Fuck you.
Well, they also come out with the whole, like, fireworks and they sing to you and all this shit.
Yeah, it's not worth $1,000.
No, hell no.
No,
hell
sorry. No. Like, off.
Yeah.
Yeah, if like Christian McCaffrey was bringing my steak like on a halfback counter, sure, I'd pay $1,000 for that. Done.
Well, Salt Bae is a celebrity.
So stupid. He's so dumb.
He's a meme for sure.
He's a meme.
All right, well, welcome back to the podcast, guys. Let me know when you guys are done. You know,
I think we're done now.
Sorry. Yep.
Anyways, topic for today.
So we're doing a series now, and I've been wanting to do this series for a long time, and it is on the assassination of Robert Kennedy.
Robert F. Kennedy.
I mean, this is a big boy.
Dude. In fact, we're going to have to do a couple parts.
I know we're going to do a couple parts. I think we're going to do about three. This is going to be about a three-bagger. I think.
You know. Little tripskies?
Yeah. And a major, massive, huge shout out.
Super huge.
And we're going to call her the head of research.
The director
of research.
Oh, we should change her Discord title.
She's a director now.
Oh, yeah. She's a director.
Yeah, she's a director.
A couple more episodes, she might be VP.
I know. Yeah. She's a director, VP, senior lead.
C-level.
Sweet C-level of research.
Oh, It's C for Caprice. She should be. We should make her thing C-level.
And her name is Caprice. Her name is Caprice, and I don't know if she wants me to say her last name, so we won't say it.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
But you know, she put a lot of work into this, and
her last name is Conspiracy.
That's right. C Caprice for Conspiracy. But we've been working on this for a couple months, and so this is part one. So we thank you. And yes. We hope you guys enjoy it.
When we get rich, we're going to send you like a deluxe care package.
For yeah. This. Yeah. We'll fly you out.
She's playing the long game. It's okay.
She's playing the long game.
She's playing the long game.
So are you guys ready? I mean, do you guys know a lot about this? Or are you guys, you know.
Dude, surprisingly.
What are your thoughts ahead of time?
Surprisingly, I don't know a lot about
this. Yeah. Same. I think.
JFK kind of overshadows it.
I know, it does.
A little bit?
Like he was
the older brother?
He was just the attorney general, loser. He wasn't the president.
Many people know the name RFK or Bobby Kennedy, but they don't know his story. Bobby was the younger brother of John F. Kennedy. And like his brother, he was on his way to creating change in the world before his life came to an early end when a gunman fired a fatal shot.
Yes.
So Robert Kennedy. So on June 5th, 1968, Bobby was in a race against Eugene McCarthy. And this was for the primary. Yeah. So the Democratic primary. That's correct,
because he was running for president.
That's right. So you know you have to win the primary, right? So you
in order to be the candidate for that party.
To get on the ballot. Yeah,
that's exactly. Right. And so this is for the Democratic Party, right? The Democratic Party presidential nomination. It was a big night for RFK. We're going to call him RFK from now
on, right? That's so much easier.
Yeah, Robert F. Kennedy. So RFK. A night of victory and celebration after winning the vote in the California primary.
That's a big one.
After hearing the results, Kennedy went to address his supporters in the ballroom of the Ambassador Hotel in Los Angeles. He gave a short speech and then he left the stage to head to a victory party.
Thank you very much. I want to express my gratitude to my dog Freckles, who's been maligned. And I don't care what they, as Franklin Roosevelt said, I don't care what they say about me, but when they start to attack my dog. I'm not doing this in the order of importance, but I also want to thank my wife, Ethel. Her patience during this whole effort is fantastic. Thank you very much. Freckles has gone home to bed. He thought very early that we were going to win, so he retired. Thank a number of other people, if I may. All of those of you who worked so hard in this campaign. All of the students who worked across this state. I think that we can end the divisions within the United States. What I think is quite clear is that we can work together in the last analysis, and that what has been going on within the United States over the period of the last 3 years, the divisions, the violence, the disenchantment with our society, the divisions, whether it's between blacks and whites, between the poor and the more affluent, or between age groups, or on the war in Vietnam, that we can start to work together. We are a great country and a selfish country and a compassionate country. And I intend to make that my basis for running and over the period of the next few months. What I think all of these primaries have indicated, if I can just take a minute or 2 minutes more of your time. What all of these primaries have indicated, and all of the party caucuses have indicated, whether they occurred in Colorado or Idaho or Iowa, wherever they occurred, it was the people in the Democratic Party and the people in the United States want a change. And that change can come about only if those who are delegates in Chicago recognize the importance of what has happened here in the state of California, what has happened in South Dakota, what happened in New Hampshire, what happened across the rest of this country. The country wants to move in a different direction. We want to deal with our own problems within our own country, and we want peace in Vietnam. The fact is that all of us are involved in this great effort. And it's a great effort, not on behalf of the Democratic Party. It's a great effort on behalf of the United States, on behalf of our own people, on behalf of mankind all around the globe and the next generation. And I would hope now that the California primary is finished, now that these primaries are over, that we could now concentrate on having a dialogue or a debate, I hope, between the vice president and perhaps myself on what direction we want to go in the United States. What we're going to do in the rural areas of our country, what we're going to do for those who still suffer within the United States from hunger, what we're going to do around the rest of the globe, and whether we're going to continue the policies that have been so unsuccessful in Vietnam of American troops and American Marines carrying the major burden of that conflict. I do not want to, and I think we should move in a different direction. So I thank all of you who made this possible this evening, all of the effort that you made, and all of the people whose names I haven't mentioned, but who did all of the work at the precinct level, who got out the vote, who did all of the effort, brought forth all of the effort that's required. I was a campaign manager 8 years ago. I know what a difference that kind of an effort and that kind of commitment makes. So I thank all of you. Those of you who are here. Mayor Yorty has just sent me a message that we've been here too long already. My thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there. Thank you.
Instead of taking the planned route, he left through the hotel's kitchen pantry at 12:15 in the morning. The hotel was buzzing with excitement, and RFK took to shaking the hands, saying the thank yous.
Of the kitchen staff?
Everybody. Hey. Yeah, walking in, saying, hey, thank you so much, etc. Pop, 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 shots are fired. Five people are wounded. And RFK is shot three times, twice in the chest and once behind his right ear.
Damn, that was like that. Damn, that's like a headshot. The fuck?
He fell to the ground, and he asked as his final words, is everyone okay?
Damn, what a wow.
Wow.
What a stand-up guy. And he's like, is everyone? But especially.
This is what they think are his last words.
Okay, well,
they're, you know what I mean?
Yeah. It's loud. Yeah. People are freaking the fuck out.
They're whispering.
But it's also it's like, that was a lot of pops. Because if five people were injured, it was like, pop, 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 pop. They got a lot. That's a lot of shots.
Yeah. A hotel associate reassured him, and Bobby relaxed. He went in and out of consciousness, and within 24 hours of the shooting, Kennedy died. And the fatal shot was to his head, and he died at LA Good Samaritan.
Shipping can make or break a sale, so optimize how you ship your orders with ShipStation. They make it easy to automate and manage orders no matter how big your business grows. And they might even be able to help reduce shipping and warehouse costs. So optimize and keep up your momentum for growth with ShipStation. Sign up for your free 60-day trial now at ShipStation.com and use the code POD. That's ShipStation.com with the code POD.
Hospital.
Damn, man. Fucking
RFK.
The Kennedy curse.
And what's crazy about this is, and before we get into the whole, you know, because we do the thing. We'll go in the backs. But we decided to tell you about the story in the front.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
What happened?
And then we'll go into the back, right? Yeah. But what's crazy is I do believe this is one of the biggest turning points in American history.
Yeah.
I believe he would have been president.
I think so too, 100%.
Yeah.
I think there's no question.
Yeah.
I mean, he had the name. He had the.
He won the Democratic Party.
He was a good dude. It was kind of a no-brainer.
Yeah. Yeah. So to understand where we're going, let's rewind and find out where we started.
Have been.
That's right.
History meets conspiracy.
Okay, so Robert Francis Kennedy was born on November 20th, 1925, in Massachusetts to Joe and Rose Kennedy. He was one of nine children, and the family lived in a very privileged life.
I mean, she got nine kids. He better be privileged.
I know. So they had homes.
Poverty.
They had homes in Cape Cod, Florida, the high-end private schools. They took their boats out for a spin for a few, you know, on the weekends. No big deal. you know, they were rich. Let's call it what it was. Yeah.
Rich bitch.
Joe, which was Bobby's father, was a devout Catholic and a political man that had high ambitions for his children, specifically the Kennedy boys. For the Kennedys, it's the outhouse or the castle. Nothing in between, his dad would say.
You're the dead to me or the king.
That's right. His goal was for his sons to follow in his political footsteps. At dinner time, the family would only entertain conversation that centered current events and history. And they had strict expectations set for them. Be at the dinner table 5 minutes before a meal. Speak specific languages at the dinner table, either English, Spanish, or French. And weigh in every Saturday for calorie checks.
Oh, wow.
Are you kidding me?
No.
Damn, this sounds like a shit life. This is like calorie checks?
It was
checks?
Just very strict. That's why they were all thin and you know.
But seriously, how are you checking calories?
Well.
And no gluten.
Hey,
no gluten.
Can you imagine Joe being like, hey, Teddy, getting a little plump around the cheekies.
He's like,
Teddy.
He's like, Teddy. Your Senate is career's over unless you lose those calories.
No. You didn't make weight.
He's like, don't. He's like, weight. Don't. Yeah. Yeah. He's like, don't worry. I'm going to work out on Chappaquiddick Island. He's like,
I'm going for a swim.
Going for a quick swim here on Chappaquiddick.
A swim 10 miles. I lost all the calories.
Only conspiracy theorists would know that reference. As a result, Bobby's priorities were centered around the Democratic Party, the Kennedy family, and God.
And Spanish and French, because that's what he spoke at the table.
The dad's favorite of the bunch was their eldest son, Joe Jr., and his least favorite was none other than Bobby, despite his shared values with his father and his commitment to those values. So do you remember this? We went over this in the JFK series.
But didn't Joe Jr. died. Yeah,
he died in World War II.
And then Joe's like, fuck.
I know. He's like,
my golden child.
But instead of for Joe, Bobby was his mother's favorite of the boys. She said he was more gentle than any of the others, and he spent a majority of his time with his sisters.
Well, so he's like, he's weak.
Yeah. But his father believed he was the runt of the litter. So you kind of get it. Like, Bobby was the mom's favorite, and Joe Jr. was the dad's favorite.
So maybe it got to a situation where it's like he was like, didn't expect anything of him. Then he was like, okay.
Yeah.
And he's one of his friends. Like, you might just be the savior of this family.
Yeah. Bobby said, quote, I was the seventh of nine children. When you come from that far down, you have to struggle to survive.
In a rich family.
Yeah.
Oh, such a struggle. In Cape Cod.
Come on now.
He stuck out amongst his brother. He didn't do well in school. He was shy. He had a stutter. He had buck teeth. And he struggled to make friends. At one of his school, he was even nicknamed Fella because he struggled to remember new classmate names.
Other Fella?
Deeming he was the one to be forgotten.
Hey, Fella. Hey, you. Fella.
Despite his own struggles, he would always stick up for the underdogs at school. He had a unique sense of sympathy because of his own experiences, unlike his other brothers who took on natural abilities.
Oh, yeah. They were like the shit. And like, you know, like JFK's like boning the cheerleaders. And he's like fucking slaying it. And he's like over there in the corner.
That's my brother. They're like, no, he's not, fella. Yeah. Being overlooked by his father, it actually bothered Bobby. But it pushed him to work harder, and he became diligent and determined. By 1943, Bobby had enlisted in the U.S. Naval Reserve. The following May, he graduated from Milton Academy and was on his way of paving a life for himself. His look on life changed drastically, though, when his oldest brother, Joe Jr., was killed in August of 94 during a plane explosion in a top-secret mission in Europe. You remember that whole story? Mm-hmm. Yeah, of his, he was doing an experimental plane.
I know. That's what I was like. Yeah. But what are they doing? Like, why are they doing this? Like,
yeah. They were devastated.
Maybe that's a conspiracy. Like
I know.
He had some debts he didn't pay, and they're like, we're taking Joe Jr. Yeah.
Bobby greatly looked up to him, and they were all devastated. Bobby's father lost hope in his eldest son taking the reins of his political hold. And this is when their father's focus shifted from Joe Jr. to JFK. That's right. Mm-hmm. Leaving Bobby again in the shadows. But it didn't stop Bobby's eagerness to do something or to be somebody. Following the end of World War II, Bobby was honorably discharged from the military, despite actually never seeing combat firsthand.
Well, good for him. No one wants to see this. Fucking sucks.
In that same year, his older brother JFK was elected to Congress. Bobby headed back to Harvard to finish his political science degree. And in this time, he earned his cherished crimson and white H playing varsity football. So this is just an accolade of playing football, and you get, sweet. You know, you're part of the crew, basically. Yeah.
He's like him and Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Yeah. like Harvard. He barely graduated. He had poor grades.
He graduated grades. With like a 1.3 GPA.
He had poor grades, but he still graduated.
Well, you know why I graduated? Because
Joe, what's his name?
Well, Joe Sr. was like, all right, I'll build you a science building.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, there you go. Like, whatever you need. So unlike Hunter Biden, his grades were not good enough to get him into an
Ivy League
school.
Yeah.
So he couldn't get into Yale. He couldn't get into Harvard. So he got into University of Virginia.
He said he was at Harvard, though. Harvard's not an Ivy League.
Harvard is an Ivy League.
I thought it is.
I think it's weird.
No, he didn't get into Harvard.
No, but you said he was at Harvard. Oh, he's going for his law degree.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, like Yes. Obviously.
Harvard is Ivy League. I went to University of Cincinnati. Like, that's the Ohio Ivy League.
That's the Ivy of Ohio.
Yeah, that's right. It's the Ivy of Ohio.
Jorge and I graduated from Hard Knocks.
Yeah.
I never said I graduated. I just said I went.
True.
So he found himself enrolled in the law program at University of Virginia with the understanding that unless he does better work than he did at Harvard, most unlikely to succeed in law. His studies began with a rocky start consisting of less studying and more skiing, golfing, and vacationing.
He's like rich man life. He's like, fuck it.
Yeah. But by his third year, he made an impact while serving as the president of the school's student legal forum. He coordinated presentations by speakers, etc. He graduated from law school in June of 51, but arguably this wasn't his largest achievement of the time. Bobby has begun dating Ethel Skakel.
Oh my God, the Skakels! That was from Martha Moxley.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that's where it all ties.
That's how they were connected.
Right.
Okay.
That's right. Yeah. So he was actually the first one to get married. So he got married to Ethel Skakel. In 1950, they wed in Greenwich, same town
that the Martha Moxley
murder happened. His brother Jack serving as his best man. Bobby and Ethel were each other's second selves and balanced each other out. He was shy and she was not. He was complicated and she was easygoing. Her lightness relieved his heaviness, and they came from similar black backgrounds of privilege.
Some of the black grounds.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Don't edit that out.
Following his graduation, he was unsure of what to do with his law degree. But with the little help of Papa Joe, he landed his first job with the U.S. Justice Department. So we're going to pause here and talk about nepotism again.
I mean, this is like class. The dude barely graduates both times.
Yeah.
And then somehow becomes the attorney general.
Not to say he's bad. Not to say he's bad or he didn't deserve it. But hear me out. I'm going to tell you my first job. And I want you to tell me your first job. My first job was working the cash register at Jamba Juice.
Fuck yeah.
Mm.
No nepotism. Sean, go for you. What was your first job?
My first job was a caddy at the golf course.
Oh, yeah?
And I was getting paid a bad job, actually.
Like
tips, and then they would like buy me lunch at the middle, after the ninth hole, they give you lunch, and I'm like, sweet.
Yeah.
My first job was at TJ Maxx.
TJ Maxx.
Yeah.
I love it.
Mm. Yeah.
So I guess the point I'm trying to bring up here is his first job was at the U.S. Justice Department.
After he barely graduated, like fucking.
His job, he began investigating Soviet spies and developing cases against corrupt officials within the Truman administration. His first job!
I think I love the most. He's like, I have no idea what I'm going to do with my law degree. Justice Department job. Like, what the fuck?
So despite his efforts in trying to do the right thing, he was seen by his peers as privileged.
No, I wonder why.
I wonder why.
I can only imagine why they would think that.
Yeah. Shortly after working for Brooklyn's U.S. Attorney's Office, Bobby made the decision to resign from his position to then start assisting his brother Jack in his upcoming Senate race. Despite JFK's election to Congress years prior, he had a battle ahead of him. And despite JFK's doubt in his younger brother's abilities for the campaign job, Papa Joe put in his recommendation.
Well, which means like you're doing it. His recommendation's like,
that's right,
you're doing it. So great. Approved.
So basically, as the years went on, Papa Joe started to pay more and more attention of the runt of the litter. Well, he started recommending him to the jobs and pushing forward his agenda.
Mm-hmm. He's like, I only have so many sons.
That's right. That's right. So then he started organizing supporters to wear clothing for Vote for Jack, identify new supporters for Jack, and got more people to the polls, delivering JFK with 71,000 more votes than his competitor and reserving him a spot in the Senate of 1952. But not only that, he then became the confidence of running a campaign.
Yeah. He's like, oh, I can do this shit.
That's right.
A fucking law degree, baby. So I got this.
In 1957, Kennedy found himself working for the Rackets Committee and organized by the Senator McClellan to investigate Teamster activity.
Oh, that wasn't and the corruption. Like Bob,
oh, yeah, the big mob, time. Yeah. And the corruption that existed within the union. Bobby was overly confident in his ability to put away the Teamster boss named Jimmy Hoffa. Away to the point, even he said, if the indictment didn't happen, he'd jump off the Capitol. He was so confident in it. By the end
jump
of the
off
trial,
the Capitol.
By the end of the trial, the jury decided Hoffa was not guilty. And Hoffa barked back with a gifted parachute and a note that read, jump, Bobby.
Oh, I love it. He's like, see you at the Capitol, Bobby.
Yeah. So with all of that, by the late 50s, Bobby had pissed off quite a few people.
And the mob is one of them.
J. Edgar Hoover, Jimmy Hoffa, the Teamsters, the KGB in Russia.
How did he piss off J. Edgar Hoover?
He was constantly trying to go against the Teamsters union.
Oh, the FBI was like, they're fine. There's nothing wrong with them.
He was also trying to say, hey, the FBI is overreaching.
They are. They constantly are.
Like their regulations or what's the word? Their jurisdiction. Yeah. Like they were just overreaching.
And Hoover obviously... He was the director of the FBI. He's a piece of shit.
That's right. So during this time, Bobby took the opportunity to frequent different areas of the world. And I quote, this is how Bobby Kennedy learned, by seeing things with his own eyes. He would take note of good and bad things, like in the Soviet Union or in low-income housing throughout the U.S., and identify solutions to try to help humanity. Bobby may have come off harsh in his methods, but at the root of it, he wanted to do right. And he wanted to force the issue. He wanted to press it and say, this is wrong and let's change it.
Well, I mean, it makes sense. Like, you take the kid who was like fucking the picked on kid and the bullied kid. And he's like, you know what? Fuck that. Justice.
Yeah.
It's like if Bruce Wayne was a dweeb and then like came to Bruce Wayne's like, fuck yeah, I'm a vengeance. I'm the knight.
A little different.
I mean, rich kid.
A little different.
Rich. I mean, it's kind of the same.
So in 1960, life again once changed for Bobby as he hesitantly transitioned into the presidential campaign leader for JFK. He didn't want to leave his career again to engage in family matters, but Papa Joe said, you must do it.
He's like, Papa Joe's like, I'm going to make a suggestion.
Yeah.
You decide what you want.
So their strategy began with a couple of phone calls that would free civil rights leaders, Martin Luther King, after being arrested for traffic violations. This popularized Jack by opening up a new sector of black voters because other politicians weren't doing much of anything about the civil rights movement.
Damn, Joe was a fucking, he was a mastermind.
I know.
That's a good chess move right there.
I know. He called it, I know I told you to arrest him, let him go. It's all part of the plan.
This action got the ball rolling in Kennedy's favor. The two brothers were very different. Jack would cut you off at the knees. Bobby would say, why are we doing this to that guy? Bobby acted as a puppet master behind the scenes, always knowing the next move or the strategy to pick up. This is why Bobby was central to Jack's success in the narrow presidential race that put JFK into the office.
Man, it's crazy. He was like Mr. Underachiever, and then became like a savant. Yep. Good for him.
So by the following year, Jack Kennedy put Bobby as the attorney general. And for Bobby, where he could aid in the progress of civil rights movement and fight against the Cuban Missile Crisis.
But don't you think that's a little bit of a reach?
Super. And this is, I mean, this is again the point of nepotism.
Yeah, I'm like, homie has used his law degree
one time.
He's not even a lawyer. He's a lawyer.
He passed the bar?
But he didn't really practice law.
That's what I'm saying. He used his law degree one time.
He was a lawyer.
Like, attorney general.
So there's a bit of nepotism. But I mean, I still hold on to the fact that hopefully he was a good guy.
No, it seems like he was a good dude. Like, yeah. It seems like he actually had the moral compass and like wanted things to be good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
You... right. The attorney general, it's
but
like,
are you qualified?
I know. It's like,
that's
know.
Another story.
Like, what was your GPA?
It is very true. And they got a lot of flack for it, for being, you know, put there.
It's like making him, we're going to make him the Surgeon General.
I know.
like, wait, what?
Yeah. What the fuck? You never did
a
surgery.
Like, I know. It's like, you don't really, you're not even a doctor. Yeah.
But in 1963, as we all know, JFK was assassinated while riding in a motorcade in Dallas.
Yes, we did that episode. 5 episodes of it.
So this sent RFK into a bit of a depression. He lost his brother that had become his closest friend. Bobby stepped down as attorney general because he didn't want to serve under LBJ.
Well, it's also because he was, I'm going to get fired because I should not be in this job. I should not be doing this job.
They're
going to find out.
Also, LBJ and RFK did not get along.
So Lyndon B. Johnson.
Yeah, so he decided to leave and resign. Yeah.
Yeah, but when he was VP, he had no power, so he's like, fuck you, LBJ.
But,
yeah,
but it was more like he just lied a little bit on his resume.
A little bit.
They asked him to do something, he's like, I feel comfortable doing this.
let's circle back.
Now that Jack's gone.
I'm on vacation.
Now that Jack's gone, yeah, I know. RFK, though, then began to scramble because he was unsure of what his future would hold. He wasn't even sure if he wanted to be in politics.
Yeah, right, and then Joe was like, excuse me, son, another suggestion for him.
But at a certain point, he decided to run for New York U.S. Senator's seat. His office worked nonstop to responding to people's needs and distresses. Phones were ringing off the hook, and Bobby's team worked diligently alongside him to push forward in the race. And at one point, he made a stop at children's mental health facilities, where he made the promise to some of the children that he'd take them to get his favorite food, ice cream. His campaign team,
like a Joe Biden story,
disapproved, knowing that Bobby couldn't uphold his promise given his busy schedule. Shortly after, Bobby had his chauffeurs take him and the children to a nearby shop where they got their ice cream.
Oh, he's like, I'm a man of my word.
Mm.
But the point is here that he, you know, he was human and he wanted to deliver the promises. You know what I mean? That was the basic.
Yeah,
By the fall of 64, he was elected as New York senator.
A man of the people.
Okay. Yeah.
Just far richer than all of
them. So Kennedy continued...
good last name.
Yeah. Kennedy continued to rally support through his work. By 1967, him and LBJ were bashing heads on different plans regarding the Vietnam War. LBJ was hungry for maintaining the war, while Bobby proposed a 3-point plan of ending the war.
Yeah, that war was pointless. The war served no purpose.
The following year in 68, RFK announced his bid to run for president. And it was going to be up against none other than Lyndon B. Johnson.
Mm.
Well, you know he was going to lose.
In his first presidential speech, Bobby took to using the same appeals that Jack had done years prior. He spoke of civil rights, unified parts of the nation like no other. He was realistic and hoped that his unification could deliver him a presidential win. He visited low-income areas of the U.S., joblessness, inadequate housing to fix. He advocated for these communities and placed their needs in the forefront of the missions. He placed a lot of focus on drawing young voters out instead of the old kind of crusty people of the 50s and
I wonder, though, I really do wonder. He's obviously, like, hitting all the right points, you know?
Yeah.
But I feel like everyone does that. I care about the poor.
Yeah.
I care about these impoverished people. I care about the poor blacks and the poor Mexicans.
It's hard to know who's true.
Yeah, but like, is it all just part of, like, and then they get in, they're like, whoopsie daisy. I know I've said it.
We're going to get to it. We're going to get to it, promise. Look,
it's on the agenda.
So his...
term two. So it's my second term.
So let me tell you, his thing was he wanted better economic policy and less foreign policy.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
He wanted more social policies that consisted of fair housing and better job opportunities. So less dealing with outside of the U.S. and more dealing with internal problems.
Still sounds like current, like, we're going to bring jobs, more jobs, jobs in America. America jobs.
Yeah, but at that time it was a good message, especially, you know, considering the war and then the civil rights. So like it fit. Yeah. It was really connecting with.
I also feel like maybe they weren't all full of shit back then. Like, yeah, they were legit.
So following, so the New Hampshire primary was pretty much first, right? Okay. It was massive. Lyndon B. Johnson literally crashed and crashed and burned. He was the sitting president, and he crashed and burned so much so that he withdrew.
He's like, I'm not running again. Like, I'm fucking out, bro.
That's what happened with Joe Biden this year? New Hampshire. He didn't.
We're in the middle of it, so I don't want to like.
No, but like it already happened with the primary.
He won with an absentee vote. He wasn't on the ballot. So okay. So here's what happened in New Hampshire. So, you know, at the bottom of your ballot, there's all the candidates.
Yeah.
And then there's a blank spot.
Yeah, like Mickey Mouse.
Oh, and then you just fucking like fill it in. He
won based on people filling in his name.
No fucking way.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
No. Biden.
That's bullshit.
In New Hampshire, live free or die, they were picking this guy. Like, what the?
We're in the middle of this, so I don't want to like, we're...
It's kind of hysterical.
Yeah, who knows what's going to happen.
It's kind of hysterical.
Okay, so he completely lost in the New Hampshire primary, right? So LBJ withdrew from the race totally, but Bobby still faced two other competitors in the Democratic nomination. So
it wasn't like an instant win.
Yeah, that's right. Like, so he was up against Senator McCarthy and VP, who was the VP at the time, Hubert Humphrey. Bobby, on April 4th, 1968, Bobby delivered an impromptu speech following the death of MLK.
I have some very sad news for all of you, and that is that Martin Luther King was shot and was killed tonight in Memphis. Martin Luther King dedicated his life to love and to justice between fellow human beings. He died in the cause of that effort. In this difficult day, in this difficult time for the United States, it's perhaps well to ask what kind of a nation we are and what direction we want to move in. For those of you who are black, considering the evidence evidently is that there were white people who were responsible, you can be filled with bitterness and with hatred and a desire for revenge. We can move in that direction as a country in greater polarization. Black people amongst blacks and white amongst whites filled with hatred toward one another. Or we can make an effort, as Martin Luther King did, to understand and to comprehend and replace that violence, that stain of bloodshed that is spread across our land, with an effort to understand compassion and love. For those of you who are black and are tempted to be filled with hatred and mistrust of the injustice of such an act against all white people, I would only say that I can also feel in my own heart the same kind of feeling. I had a member of my family killed, but he was killed by a white man. But we have to make an effort in the United States. We have to make an effort to understand, to get beyond or go beyond these rather difficult times. My favorite poem, my favorite poet was Aeschylus. He once wrote, "Even in our sleep, pain which cannot forget falls drop by drop upon the heart, until in our own despair, against our will, comes wisdom through the awful grace of God. What we need in the United States is not division. What we need in the United States is not hatred. What we need in the United States is not violence and lawlessness, but is love and wisdom and compassion toward one another, feeling of justice toward those who still suffer within our country, whether they be white or whether they be black. We can do well in this country. We will have difficult times. We've had difficult times in the past, but we will have difficult times in the future. It is not the end of violence. It is not the end of lawlessness, and it's not the end of disorder. But the vast majority of white people and the vast majority of black people in this country want to live together, want to improve the quality of our life, and want justice for all human beings that abide in our land. And what dedicate ourselves to what the Greeks wrote so many years ago, to tame the savageness of man and make gentle the life of this world. Let us dedicate ourselves to that and say a prayer for our country and for our people. Thank you very much.
It was a tight race, and people sat on the edge of their seats, and it was all about the California primary and the huge primary that would propel the winning competitor forward into the presidential race. Now, many thought that whoever won the Democratic primary would be essentially a shoe-in.
Yeah, a shoe-in for the president.
Because everybody was done with LBJ and Nixon.
Oh my God, everyone hated Nixon.
It was just
I'm not a crook thing.
Yeah, that's right. So Bobby and his campaign team sat eagerly waiting to hear the results. And finally, those results came in. Bobby won California with 46% of the vote.
Dude, if you win California, because since California has the most electoral votes of any, it's like you're kind of like, you're the man.
So the entire Democratic Party and the United States was ecstatic.
Yeah, they're like
happiness, like
jubilee.
Very excited.
Yeah, like jubilant. Like yeah.
Never heard of that. Okay.
Yeah. But what would happen hours after the win would leave the nation reeling, and the change of history happened, which was she was murdered. And so here we are.
No, I mean, I think that it's kind of interesting to think about kind of his path, how he kind of weaseled his way. I'm going to say
weasel.
I want to say weaseled. Weasel's the wrong one. I'm going to say Joe Senior weaseled his way kind of in, because it seems like he was an underachiever, this underachiever, and then managed to obviously be good at campaigning for his brother. And then somehow his brother's like, yeah, you'd be a great attorney general because you have a law degree that you've never used, and this would be perfect. I think he was more of like an activist type kind of guy, you know, like he could have been like a great, like a pro bono lawyer guy.
Yeah.
I'm going to take on your shitty case, 'cause you know, I care about you. But I feel like the stage was too big for him.
Yeah.
He got thrust into a situation where he shouldn't have actually been in.
I agree with that.
And then he was going to win.
Yeah.
And the thing is, he was going to win. He was going to win, and it was like,
but he pissed off too many people.
I think
specifically the mob.
I think that the mob probably has a big hand. It probably has a very large hand.
Yeah.
In this, totally. I mean, we'll find out more.
Yeah, we're going to get into it more.
More on episode 2 and 3.
Stay tuned.
No, but I do think that was cool, because there's a lot of that I didn't know. I didn't really realize how much.
Yeah.
You know, I just knew, you know, obviously he got killed, and he, you know, obviously he was attorney general, and he was a good dude. And I mean, supposedly, based on our other evidence, he might have also been Marilyn Monroe. I mean, supposedly.
Based on our other episodes of the Marilyn Monroe murder.
It's so funny how, like, all these episodes, like, we've done, and they all meld tie into together. Each other. talked about Tepequitic.
The Skakels, Tepequitic, the Maryland.
I mean, they all are regarding the Kennedys. So.
Isn't it wild?
Yeah.
There's a lot of the Kennedy is like the conspiracy family. Yeah. So
I mean, like, they give us unlimited content.
I know.
And now on episode 790.
It's true. But let me ask you some questions about this, because I feel the Democratic Party then is not what it is.
I fully agree.
Even the Republican Party.
Yeah.
I mean, the Republican Party. I feel like both of them are just very extremist now.
Yeah.
You know?
Dude, I'm in full agreement with that. I feel the Democratic Party of the 60s and 70s was like the shit.
I would have.
Dude, 100%.
I would have been.
No, but yeah, I would have been. For sure. I would have been fully in support of the Democratic Party back then. 100%. Like, fully on board.
Yeah.
Like, they were actually.
It wasn't
legit.
Really a gun issue.
No.
Right?
No. I think it was more or less at that time, it seemed like the Republican Party was more government control. And then the Democratic Party was like power to the people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then now it's like
the movement I could have gotten more behind.
Now it almost seems like it's flipped. And so now it's like the Democratic Party appears to be more let the government take care of you.
Yeah.
Government. We Democratic. Got you back. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And then now the Republican Party is more fucking America, freedom. You fucking take control.
You got your freedoms, and we don't want to step on those. And
but they are both, like Jorge said, I think they are both very radicalized.
Yeah.
Extreme. And it's to the point where people literally hate other people for their, like, that's when you know it's not at a good point. When literally people hate another person because of their party affiliation. Mm. Like, how? Well, how could you hate somebody just because?
Do you think it was like that? Do you think it was like that before Trump? Like, as far as, like, people hating on each other just for your political party.
Well, there was a semblance of it with Obama.
Not as bad, though. I think, obviously.
Not as bad.
No, but not. There was a semblance of hope with Obama, wasn't there?
Well, sure. Everyone believed.
Yeah.
Of, like, because we were right off the cusp of 9/11 and in the. We didn't actually have the financial decline until Obama.
Well, yeah, 2008.
It was more just, we're done with Bush.
I think everyone was like, oh, on, my God. Man, we've been in Bush. Iraq for
Afghanistan and Iraq for, like, so long.
But I think that's the only reason why I ever believed that election, the 2020 election, was bullshit. Because there's no way in any universe that Joe Biden got more votes than Barack Obama. Barack Obama was like the great like savior of.
Well, wait a minute, what are you talking about? Joe Biden wasn't up against.
No,
yeah, 2020.
Barack Obama.
No, he's saying against Trump.
Oh, you said Obama.
No, I didn't. Joe Biden got more votes than Obama got.
Oh, back then. Comparison.
So my point is, like, that's what the only thing that made me be like, this might be bullshit, because you take the arguably one of the most charismatic men who's ever lived, and literally the entire country was like, okay, this guy might be the shit. Like, he actually might be real. And everyone's like, you know what? I'm actually down.
And I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that Obama brought out the black vote and the Mexican vote.
Dude.
Yeah.
In more ways than not.
Obama,
you know what I mean?
Dude, Obama ran, dude, I'm telling you, he had both sides being like, this guy's good. Like,
they're like,
you know what? Maybe he's right. Like, so maybe he's the one. Like, so he's like Neo.
The population didn't increase that much.
No, dude, it's impossible. Like, I don't,
because that's what they attributed to, is just population increasing.
Well, either that or just like they attributed to, like, the thing that doesn't make any sense, because I get it, people will vote against Trump because they don't like him. That's fine. But the fact that Trump got 75 million votes or something, and then Biden got 80 million, I was like, okay.
88, I think, or something.
Like,
it was crazy.
I'm sorry, but I mean, I don't even know. It doesn't make any sense, because I'm telling you, like, Obama was the best fucking Democratic candidate that they've had in 30 years.
And how many votes did he get? Do you know?
I think he got 68 or something like that. 70.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's to me, I'm like, because I'm sorry, but that dude's charismatic as fuck. He's a great speaker.
I agree with that.
Holy
with
shit. That. Amazing speaker.
So let me throw out a scenario. Mm. Yeah. Okay, so this happened. So RFK died.
Yes, facts.
Yeah, and he
or
won so the primary.
Or so we believe.
So RFK won the Democratic primary.
Yeah, he would be the president.
100%. You know who won instead? Who became the president?
No, actually, no. I don't.
Nixon.
The Republican candidate?
So, yeah. So what course would have America have taken if...
If they didn't have Watergate?
If he didn't die. if he didn't die. You know what I mean? I think it's a wild moment in our
history.
Because we had Vietnam. Mm. We had Nixon in the Watergate,
Watergate
situation. Right. He was reelected.
Dude, like, I know, which is amazing.
He won four, and then he was reelected for two, for four more, but then he resigned.
He got reelected for four more, but he also got the majority of the vote. He had like 90% of the vote. It was like ridiculous. But I also think that, like, from a perspective of, and which is why, like, secretly I kind of like Nixon, is because because he was so overt. He was such a prick that he didn't care. He wasn't trying.
True.
He wasn't trying to, like, sugarcoat it and be a
politician.
Like, yeah, he wasn't a politician. He was like, I'm an asshole. Yeah, and like, he was like, that's what I'm fucking doing. Fucking fuck you. True. And that's all. Like, I kind of respect that. Yeah. I kind of respect you for being.
I think that's what a lot of people like about Trump.
Yeah, he's very a dick. He's an asshole.
Yeah.
Are you saying Trump and Nixon are similar?
Fuck yeah, they are. Dude, they're totally similar. They're totally similar. Like,
I just think it's a weird.
Trump literally told someone he would slap them in the pussy, like straight up. Dude, I'm like, come on. He literally said that.
I think it's a strange exercise to go, like, you know, we went that path and all of a sudden we were on the path of Robert Kennedy and then it went Nixon.
Yeah.
And then all through the 70s was Nixon and Watergate scandal and all of that. You know what I mean? And then it all led to actually a major crash in the 80s. There was a major recession in the 80s.
True.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And anyways, it's just an interesting divergent of America.
I mean, there's also like is a thing about. I mean, recessions are very cyclical. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are, mm-hmm. and they almost mathematically proven, and that's why obviously so many people made money off of 2008 because they were like, oh, well, the writing's on the wall.
Yeah.
So it's like it's hard. It's really easy to blame, and I don't,
single person or whatever. Yeah,
you know, usually it's not whoever takes office, and you're like, oh, you're fucked. You know, because it is. There's much, like, the president is at a very important post. You know, the president doesn't control the economy. You know, the economy is the economy itself. And so it's hard to blame the president. Even now, it's, you know, obviously, like, the gas prices and everyone, it's really easy to blame Biden. It's like, it's Biden's fault. I mean, obviously, Biden is a factor, but not necessarily is he the sole reason why. It's the way it is.
Yeah, but like if a company is not doing good, you're going after the CEO.
Exactly. I understand that. That's actually a spectacular point, right? But my point is it's really easy to blame the one who's quote unquote in charge, even though, let's be honest, the president really isn't in charge.
Yeah.
If you look at all the rules and all the bills that get passed and all the things that actually change are actually done in the Senate and in Congress.
That's the good thing about America. We're not a dictatorship. It's not because he doesn't have the ability to rule and
correct.
Yeah. And then just, you know,
we'll see
establish
and that's
law
why,
or whatever.
You know what I think the real problem is? Why does the president have a term limit, but senators don't and congressmen don't?
Oh, that's bullshit. That's another episode.
No term limit? Oh, really? They can just be forever? And who's voting on the bills that actually change our lives? The president isn't.
Right. That's what I'm saying.
Your representatives are. Your representative. They represent you. Yeah, and meanwhile Nancy Pelosi's worth like $700 million and her husband happens to make he's the best financial wizard since the Oracle of Omaha. Like, get the fuck out of here, bro. Like, get the fuck off. Yeah, it's such bullshit. That's why I think the real corruption is in the Senate and the Congress.
Interesting.
Not the president. Like, yeah. I don't think Biden. I don't think Biden's running. I don't think Biden's run the show. I don't think Biden's.
We
like,
give them too much credit. Is basically or the president.
We no because
we
the,
give them
the,
too
the,
much credit
because the president is like the president's. Like, imagine like a really high profile actor. And imagine like Brad Pitt.
Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. And then the movie sucks, but they're like, fucking Brad Pitt. But like the director's like, in the back, like, I wrote the script. I wrote the script and I directed this. Well, sorry.
Yeah. I mean, that's a fair point. That's a good point. But again, it all starts with, you know, him, the policy that he's trying to drive.
Totally. So even in companies, we always run it up to the boss.
Right.
True.
Right.
But you want to know the best point ever? So we're in a democratic republic. That's a democratic republic. So who makes the decision? It's the people. But the people don't actually make the decision. The people's representatives make the decision. Mm. Who are the people's representatives? Your senators and your congressmen.
Yeah.
So who makes the decision in this country? The senators and the congressmen. Because they're the collective vote of the people they represent.
That are getting lobbied by people like Hunter Biden.
Exactly. Dude.
True. You're not wrong.
Exactly. Yeah. Have you ever wondered why every bill is roughly 7,000 pages? And you got
10 minutes to look it over.
They literally have like 6 hours to read through it. I'm like, you know, on an audiobook, that would be like 7 days of fucking audiobook.
Nonstop.
No, but like, see, that's to me that the real corruption is in those people because they are representing your votes. They are representing your power. Mm. Your congressmen and your senators are representing your power.
Happen on like Saturday at like 2 a.m.
Not even Saturday, like a Tuesday night. You're asleep. You're like, I work in the morning. And then they're like, surprise, the bill was passed.
Patriot Act.
Yeah. And you're like,
what the Patriot?
Patriot Act.
Dude, the Patriot Act is probably the most one of the most fucked up pieces of legislation that's ever existed. Yeah. Yeah. All I have to do is be like, you're a terrorist. And then you have no rights. Like,
no, it's very similar to the 60s communism.
The secret words, national security.
I know.
Oh. If you're suspected of communism, just like shoot you on sight.
Well, so I mean, what we're going to do here is this is kind of like learning about RFK and learning about, you know, his life. And I know it was a very small snapshot, and there's lots of documentaries out there that you should check out.
Oh, totally. Yeah, 100%.
And learn about his life because, you know, I've fallen in love with this guy, to be frank. Like, if you really watch all the documentaries, I mean, aside from his side sexual proclivities.
That's why Eric fell in love with
his stuff. No, what he did, some of it is just so moving and so it's so wonderful. And I really enjoy it. So if you have a chance, go check out the documentaries about his life. We try to do it in a very, very small
compressed amount of time.
Very small amount of time. And that way we could build up to what happened with the murder. Because the next two episodes are going to be about the night. About the murder.
And shmurder.
You notice we said the shot behind the ear. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Well, the official report is that he was shot from in front.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you get shot in the ear?
It's one front. The ear it's from like the front. They bend it. They bent the bullet. The one. Yeah.
Another magic bullet happened, basically.
Lee Harvey Oswald from the balcony.
Yes, exactly. So anyway, so that's why we did this is because we wanted to tell you a little bit about the story of RFK.
Yeah, and I also wanted to get into it about my extreme distrust of the government. Yes. And if you haven't noticed by yet.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. And not to mention the fact that RFK Jr. is a staunch believer that the CIA killed his dad.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
You know, staunch. He's very public about it. Very, very public
all the time.
About it. Yeah. And so it's gotta lend some legitimacy to it, right?
I mean, shit. Like, it's just like when we did MLK. MLK's family is like,
I know,
they you gotta believe them.
I mean, a little bit. At least you have to be open to hearing the discussion.
Of course, they were advocating for the person who got convicted to not that he wasn't the killer. Yeah,
exactly.
And like, if that's your dad. And you're diehard that dude didn't kill your dad. I mean, you got to be onto something.
Nah, seriously.
Because you'd want blood. I mean, you want vengeance and like you want justice.
Yes. Yeah. That's right. Before we jump off, I got to tell you guys to don't forget to subscribe. Make sure you follow us on social media.
That's right.
And if you didn't know, we have a Patreon.
Yeah, yes, that's right. And you know, I'm so happy Jorge brought this up. We're actually going to be opening our Discord to all people, all listeners. Mm. You will only get access to general chat, like the plebs that you are. But if you pay like our premium people, you will get access to all of like the 17 different chat categories that we have in there.
So just imagine this is kind of like public radio. So we just get support from you guys. This is not a...
Yeah, it's like PBS.
This is this is not a major profit situation. No,
like we work other... The reason we don't put out more than one episode a week is because we're working at our other jobs to support our families.
So if you like it, please support us in some way, whether that's sharing on social media or it's... being part of our Patreon. And if you don't like us,
we don't want to keep listening, but don't tell us that you don't like us.
Just
keep eating
fast forward. Yeah.
So if you want access to the Discord, then send us a message on Instagram.
Send us a message on Instagram. We'll also post it. We'll make a post like that has the Discord link.
But we'll put it in the show notes.
Yeah,
right? on Spotify.
Oh, yeah, it's a good idea.
You put a link in there. Yeah, that's the free version of joining us, by the way. But there's also, like, the paid, you know, Patreon that gets you access to the full Discord chat, by the way. But also you get...
if, like, there's various tiers.
Yeah.
If you get into our rich guy tier, like, we just did it live, and we were talking about Hannah. She's one of our rich guy members.
Yeah.
Every rich guy subscriber gets to then choose
an episode.
Yep. That we have to do. Contractually obligated to do.
Keep in mind, it takes us about 2 months to do that. So don't expect immediately. Yeah.
It will happen, though, eventually, I promise.
But, and you might ask yourself, why would you join? Well, here's the thing is, we've said this many times, we're three guys with three high school diplomas. But that's who the people are. That's who we are. That's who everybody is.
That's 90% of America, baby.
You get to hang out with us and come chat in
Discord. Yeah, and we like the feedback. And everything that you guys say or that the feedback is provided or the research that's done, it helps us sway our either our content or our decisions or our opinions.
Yeah. So, and it's also fun. I mean, honestly, like, you know how we are. I'm constantly talking shit to both of these guys.
Yeah, he's the worst.
You should see the Discord.
That's all right. We can take it. You guys can come join us.
But I'm saying it's fun.
Come shit on us.
Yeah, that's right. Like you get to shit on us. And like and before we become like Joe Rogan, where like I refuse to be shit on.
Yeah.
You can shit on us now.
That's right.
All right.
All right, once again, we're out of here. One last thing, which is thanks again, Caprice.
Yeah, see for Conspiracy Caprice, you're the best.
Appreciate it.
This one's for you, Caprice.
We'll catch you guys later.
99.